Oh, hi there, Super Ninfriendos. I didn't see you standing there. What's going on? It's NVC episode 630. I am your host, Seth Macy, joined here today by Pierre Schneider.
Hello, Seth.
John Warren.
Hi, Seth.
Hi, and Charles Hart.
Hello, wahoo.
Charles, I just wanted to point out your last name is actually an anagram for Hart, which I thought was really neat.
That's true. Yeah, I personally never thought about that before. It's really...
Can you see anagrams, Seth, or something? Like, do you look at words and you see anagrams?
Oftentimes, yes.
Wow. It's like he's in his mind palace, like Sherlock, just piecing this stuff together all the time.
Yep. Jeremy's iron. That's a Simpsons reference.
Well, Seth was always, you know, when he was going home after school, he would look for his name on the mailbox, but he would end up at the YMCA all the time.
That is literally, when I figured that out. Yeah. That was good.
Or the Macy's.
Wow.
Yep.
That was the easier joke there, John.
Sometimes.
Thanks, Charles. Appreciate it.
We'd pick up a prescription at my cousin Far Macy's.
Awesome. Anyway. Thank you, Matt. Okay.
This is great. I love all the listeners that have dropped off this episode.
Yeah, that's sorry it about that. We should get right into it. We're changing things up a little bit this week, format-wise. We are going to start by talking about the games that we have been playing lately. Pear, you've been a very busy game player over the last, since the last time you were on the show. Would you please give us a little rundown of something that you've been playing this week that's been interesting to you or not interesting, as it will be the case when you get to me?
So I was, I just closed the NVC doc, so I have to look at my Switch to find out all the games that I was playing. So I finished Railways, which is this little kind of like flight path type touchscreen game. It's very good. I talked about it before, and it was broken before, and you couldn't finish it, and they patched it, and it's good. So if you have a couple of bucks, it's really nice. I'm playing Blossom Tales. I gotta say, after my initial excitement over playing something that feels and looks like Link to the Past, it's losing me a little bit. I don't know if you guys are playing Blossom Tales too. It's just like I don't know what it is. I'm gonna stick with it. I'm gonna keep playing it. I played a game called Train Valley. Well, this is Blossom Tales we're watching right now. So Blossom Tales is exactly like the first one. We all loved it. I think it is very much a Link to the Past type experience where the world opens up and you get new powers, and it is exactly that sort of like 2D top-down experience. And the second one has more powers. There's just something about it where the world isn't as interesting as I was hoping for it to be, but I'm going to keep on playing, see how the dungeons are. It's fun. Okay. Train Valley, I played that. That is a train simulation. I don't know what it is with trains.
I'm listening.
Actually, I went to, when my mom was here visiting from Germany, I went to the train museum in Sacramento again, which is the greatest museum in the world, of course. it's got giant Wild West trains and all of that stuff. Cool. It's really cool. So I've been inspired, and I've played Train Valley, which is a sim. I feel like it's a little bit better at home on PC because it does feel like you need that mouse control, but it's really fun. You can play, you have to plan railways, and you have to kind of initiate when the trains leave each station. And then of course there's that element where you got to make sure that you're switching things right so you don't have collisions, but it also has that sort of SimCity building aspect. It's pretty cool. Horizon Chase 2, which is not yet on Switch, but coming next year. It's out on iOS if you have Apple Arcade. And everybody here knows Horizon Chase Turbo is the second best racing game on the Nintendo Switch after Mario Kart.
Whoa.
Wow.
Playing a party game called Camp Out where four people work together building a camp. It's fun. It does feel like it does feel, you can tell it's been made by a small indie dev. It's like a labor of love. I'm not in love with the art style and things, but it's got some clever elements, and my kids and I had a lot of fun playing lots of Splatoon. Amazing,
of course,
that game. And then I'm gonna wrap this up just quickly because I feel like because I've been traveling so much, I played so much, but we have a lot of old people on the podcast today now, and so obviously got to bring up the old people genre game, Return to Monkey Island, which Ryan McCaffrey reviewed for us, and he really, really liked it because Ryan McCaffrey is also an old people genre person. It's just really kind of charming and nice to go back to this kind of classic LucasArts style adventure game where you're the fun is derived from the writing about the menial things and the kind of mundane, right? Like you're looking at something on a wall and you can tell what it is, but then the way your character reacts to it or the NPCs talk about it, that's where a lot of the fun lies. Like a lot of people, I had a hard time getting used to the art style because I have played the old games. And right. So that's not what my Guybrush looked like either. Right. But it grew on me. The animation is cool. The voice acting is cool. I'm digging it. You guys play it?
Yeah, I've started Return to Monkey Island, and I'm in love with it. It's kind of a return to that LucasArts style I really like, but this is still a point and click adventure game. I want to be very clear about it, but they've kind of removed some of the friction that was with the older games. I feel like they had that verb system that I don't think has aged particularly well.
No. Scum.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And I think like they've removed some of the friction to get into this game. So you really just get into the writing and the art style and kind of the world that they've built. And they've been kind of building it for 30 years, and Ron Gilbert's back, and that's very exciting. So yeah, I've been enjoying it.
But you have to be patient, right? It's like you may be in a room and there are 20 things to look at, and maybe one of those things is something that you might need.
Yeah.
And then, you know, the puzzles range from the, oh, I get it immediately when they talk about it, to the, you know, the apology frog and things like that, where they're obscure, but it's almost a throwback to when games were more obscure, like Resident Evil, put the jewel in the eyeball and the door opens, you know, that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
That for me, I was obviously not around when these games were like in their prime.
Heyday, yeah.
Thanks, man.
But it's always been like an appealing genre to me, but I think that friction is always what has put me off from coming to it. And I think the art style of this, for someone like me, it looks like a cartoon I would watch growing up, and it feels like there's less friction, if that makes any sense. Like, it feels like it's got they're trying to make it a more universal appeal. So I haven't played it, but this is definitely on my radar. I'm very interested in it.
Yeah, fun. My question is to John, because I also haven't played it, to John Parrott, but how often does the game stop and you have to switch floppy disks?
Yeah, it's like it's every few minutes. It's not as bad. I will say the floppies taste better than your typical Switch cart, so it's not that bad.
All right.
I hate to keep pulling the age card, but I have no idea what you're talking about. Like, not even a little bit of a
crap. Surely you've seen the floppy disk icon next to save menu options.
On Microsoft Word, absolutely.
That's right, and wondered what the hell is that. I do like this sort of kind of, like, the game is very self-referential. There are lots of throwbacks to the original game. Like, the lore from the original game has been misinterpreted. There's a museum where the curator tells you all sorts of facts about things from the old games that it's all wrong.
Uh-huh.
It's all wrong, and Guybrush keeps on saying, like, no, I'm pretty sure that didn't happen that way. He's like, no, it absolutely did. You know, I'm the expert on it. So it has a lot of fun stuff like that for returning players that will go over the heads of new ones, but it also has jokes about, you know, Elder Scrolls horse armor, right? Like, there's a pre-order bonus of an item that does nothing in your inventory, that sort of stuff.
Nice. All right. John, have you been playing anything other than Monkey Island
that is particularly notable? The Splatoon hater is logged on.
All right. Well, this was a mistake. Okay,
well, that's it.
This is the show now, huh?
I was going to say all the comments had been previously positive.
Listen, I think Splatoon is one of those games I've tried to pick up thrice now.
Mm-hmm.
And all three times I have bounced off it horribly. And I'm just going to realize it's just not for me.
Yep.
I have a real tough time with the controls. The motion stuff works the best. I get it, but I'm still just very frustrated with it. And this game oozes with style, and I love the idea of being kind of in the, like, my favorite parts of this game are being in the lobby in the city and like talk, you know, like looking at people's little comments and stuff. That's really great. I wish I loved this game, but I don't. But I've been trying to love it.
Have you ever done Salmon Run with, like, some people you know, like players that you can chat with?
No, I have no friends. I have no one no, it's like I haven't done that. I should.
Yeah.
Mostly if I'm getting together with friends these days, it's to play Fortnite, which is really nuts. But it's like I should do this. I keep getting told I should do this, and maybe this weekend I'll correct that.
It's like, yeah, it's like horde mode. And I have three kids. My daughter, she's back in Japan now, but she was visiting too. And we sat in the living room with four Switches, and we just, we went online and we played Salmon Run. We played other game modes too. But
sounds delightful.
It's just like, like nobody wants to go to sleep. It's right. Just such a great mode, and That's it can cool. be frustrating when you lose. And the one thing I'll say about Splatoon is the connection errors are still around. Like, they have not figured out the server issues yet, which is a big issue. But
hey, Nintendo, like, anytime you want to invest in some of that online stuff, like, anytime now.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Charles, what about you, the young whippersnapper over there?
The youngin. I've also been playing some Splatoon 3. I think I'm in a similar spot as John, but I think I respect it a little more than John does. I think I'm just very bad at it. And I've last night or a few nights ago, I was like, you know what? I'm gonna take another crack at Splatoon 3. And I had like three games where I lost really badly. And it was a point where it's like, you know, there's enough games. I don't need to force myself to like this one. I don't think it's a bad game at all. I just don't think it's a Charles game.
I can see that. There are plenty of games I can't get into that I, lots of people love. Like Returnal, I eventually dropped off because I'm like, I apparently don't like to do the same thing over and over. Yeah. But I appreciate it for its design ideas and the look and the sound and everything is really cool in that game. I wanted to love it. Splatoon is one of those games that when I saw it previewed at E3, I'm like, this is not for me. And then I played it with Jose, who, now works for Nintendo, was at IGN before. And we just got hooked, and we couldn't believe how Nintendo figured out how to get Japan to play first-person shooters, right? Like, it was just such a unique game. And then I feel like every iteration has gotten better with, Salmon Run added. But it is very daunting to get into now. And especially it depends on the time of day when you play. Like when a lot of kids are on who haven't played this game, you'll feel like a king. But when the Japanese players are playing,
and taking notes. I want to feel like a big bully. Let's do it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Right.
Perfect for that. But what else? Is there anything else you've been playing that maybe you have enjoyed a little bit more?
Yeah, I've also been playing John briefly mentioned I was playing it right before the call. Shovel Knight did came out like an hour ago.
Yeah.
I have it on Apple Arcade, so I'm not playing it on Switch, but it is on Switch. It's just good fun. I think it scratched an itch I didn't know needed to be scratched until I picked it up.
Yeah.
It's procedurally generated. You're always digging downwards, and it's I guess kind of roguelike-y. I don't know. I made that into a new adjective, and the adjective already exists. But it's very fun, and it's what was surprising to me is that it's procedurally generated, and it doesn't feel like it at all.
Oh, that's
like,
great.
It feels like I like genuinely looked it up again to say like, was this all planned out? There's like a little prologue tutorial section that I'm pretty sure was planned, but I think they just have figured out how to make a really good screen and what elements you can vary on that. I'm not very far in it, but it felt very good, and I will definitely be going back to it.
Awesome. I totally forgot that that was coming out. I saw the review today on IGN too, and I was like, oh my god.
Yeah. I did too. Like earlier this week, I was like, I wonder when that's coming out, and all the reviews hit, and it looks really cool.
Yeah. I'm definitely going to pick that up. I love Shovel Knight, and hearing good things about it makes me more excited. I have yet to be disappointed by Shovel Knight. Which brings me to what I've been playing, which did disappoint me. Last week, I got the download on the eShop email that they send out with all the new games. And I was looking through it, and I saw a game called Various Daylife. And I was like, well, that name is real dumb and bad. And then it said from the creators of Octopath Traveler and Triangle Strategy. I was like, oh, a game with a horrible name from,
Square? I love Octopath. What?
Yeah. And it's like, it's got RPG elements. And I was like, yes, awesome.
The sequel to Mundane Walking?
Yeah, what names were on the cutting floor there that they decided Various Daylife is the best option that we have? It's fascinating to me.
Casual interactions.
It is not for me. And within the first 10 minutes, of playing it, I was like, I just spent $25 on this game that I'm never going to play again. Yeah. It's originally it was an Apple Arcade game. I thought it was just going to be a throwback. Like, I'm always looking for turn-based RPGs because that's just what I grew up with. And I love turn-based RPGs. And none of the new ones, with the exception of like Bravely Default, have really hit for me. I don't really like the action elements in a lot of, you know, Xenoblade 3 notwithstanding, but I was excited for that reason to pick this one up. And it's just bad and boring and lame. You just walk along a corridor. So it's Final Fantasy 13, basically. And then there's just battles that aren't any fun. Sorry to all the Final Fantasy 13 fans out there. I know. Out there. I know after the first 30 hours, it really gets good. It
really opens up after.
Always that. Tells me. So Various Day Life was super disappointing. I was hoisted by my own petard on that one because of the dumb name was the whole reason that I bought it. I was like, I'm going to like this. The name is working. Horrible.
You're encouraging them.
Stop. I know. Ah, shoot. I didn't even think of that. Well, I voted with my wallet and I voted wrong. But I also got a copy of Bionic Commando for the NES. I bought off of eBay because Jeremy Parrish just did a video about it. And I was like, you know what? I love Bionic Commando. Sadly, my NES 72-pin connector needs to go back into the pot of boiling water for 5 to 10 minutes because I can't play any of my NES games anymore. The pins are not working. Too al dente. Yeah. It's too al dente right now. But Bionic Commando is one of the best NES games, and they did a modern version of it for Xbox Arcade that you just can't play anymore. You
can't play it anymore. Yep.
No, and it's a huge bummer because it's like a one-to-one remake with modern graphics, and it's so fun, and it's really, really challenging, and the music is incredible. But if you've never played the NES version, and if you have a way to play it, I cannot recommend it enough. Also, it's not very expensive. I think I paid like $15 or $16 on eBay for one of the best NES games of all time. I also ordered another secret game that I'm going to reveal right now that I got like right before the show. My Apple Watch went off from eBay like it does a lot. Tell me that the package I ordered is coming early. And that game is Donkey Kong 64. Boom, 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 boom.
Wow. Is it too late to cancel?
No, absolutely not. One of the best N64 collectathons.
I see the error you made. You know Donkey Kong and you played the Amazing Arcade game and you think this is like it.
The Amazing Arcade game is in Donkey Kong 64. That's one of the banana challenges. Okay.
That's fine. You should. That's definitely worth it. The rest of the game, though.
I love this game so much. I 101%ed it. I got every banana plus whatever, like the giant one that you get. It was a long time ago.
Can you pitch this game to me as someone who I think only knows the DK rap in reference to
great
this
question.
Game?
Yeah. So you've got your Donkey Kong, and you've got his family members.
Wrong. Okay, right. Good. You have your Donkey Kongs.
Yeah.
You have your
Kongs. The congregation.
There's. Man, I can't pitch this game.
Imagine
that's not promising.
I can pitch it. Imagine Banjo-Kazooie, but somebody put 4 billion collectibles into it.
I'm listening.
And then it looks a little bit like Banjo-Kazooie, but it doesn't run as nicely. And each level is just super boring.
Yeah, that sounds about right from what I remember. Yeah.
But you can shoot.
I want to support Seth here. I feel bad. Well,
here's the good news is in spite of being one of the hidden gems of the N64 era, it's like $11 to buy on eBay. Yeah.
It's not a hidden gem. It sold really well. Look, I don't hate it that much, but it was a major disappointment for me after Banjo-Kazooie. And I already felt Banjo-Tooie was going in the wrong direction, just making the games were getting too bloated and too big and too wide. And Mario 64, I really loved the kind of the level design in the early Nintendo and Rare platformers, and it just got bigger and bigger. You will get lost in these games, not because the world is so big, it's because it doesn't fit together right. You know? Yeah. But it has its
charms.
Oh, this way, that one.
The like, you know, a speed run like on GDQ, those are usually very entertaining, but I feel like that's kind of all those are
good. That's all speed runs is the problem. Is every speed run is fun to watch.
Yeah, every speed run is good. Yes.
I might play it again. But
when it comes to Nintendo Switch Online eventually.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it will. But it's like it's the thing that irked me about it, it's like the collectibles aren't clever, right? Like you're playing as Donkey Kong and you can see the collectibles for the other characters, so you know to come back at them. But it's like many of them are just there. They don't lead you down a new path. There are elements where the special powers of the other Kongs, like, you know, you utilize them to get something. But most of it is just, it's just so much stuff.
It's the best Metroid game on Nintendo 64.
Yeah.
Wow.
All right.
Yep, there it is. I think that's it for what we've been playing. One of the criticisms that people have been giving constructively, by the way, thank you to everybody who's been like shouting out our requests for criticisms, was that we don't say the name of the game after we talk about it. But if you go to IGN playlists, you can see the games that we talk about on the show, and you can make your own playlist. I made a playlist of every game I ever reviewed at IGN, and it's like, whoa, I've reviewed like 38 games, which is bananas to me. I've got Donkey Kong 64 on the brain. But anyway, let's move on to Mario and Rabbids Sparks of Hope. We're not really going to touch on the preview very much because Reb couldn't be here today, and I want Reb on to talk about her preview. But go check it out on IGN.com. Reb got about 4 hours of hands-on with it and had nice things to say about it. Apparently, the openness in this one gives the game more room to breathe, literally, because it's more open, so they have more room to like breathe. Not literally, but and the rabbits. Hey, the rabbits talk now. Nobody knows what they say.
But did they talk in the last game?
There's an interesting little story in one of Reb's previews about how the lead designer was told, like, in no shape or circumstance can the rabbits ever speak. And he's like, but they didn't say rabbits couldn't sing. And the singing rabbit turned out to be one of the most popular elements of Kingdom Battle. And so this time Ubisoft was like, yeah, go ahead, make them talk. So they talk now.
The forking of like the minions and rabbids to kind of see
what
different like qualities that each of them have. That's one of the most interesting stories of the millennium, I feel like.
You know, I mean, would you please? I feel like the rabbits were a little bit like the What's Up commercial, right?
Yeah.
Where it's like we all thought it was hilarious at first when the rabbits screamed it in our faces. And then after a while, you're like, all right.
Okay,
that's enough now, Ubisoft, right? And like, but I think the shame here is that with the last games, I think there were a lot of people like, well, the rabbits annoy me, so I'm not going to play it. But playing the game, the rabbits were not annoying in the game. And it was this really cool combination of these like corrupted Nintendo characters in rabbit form. I saw somebody in the NVC Facebook group saying that when they played the original game, they often had to remind themselves that it wasn't made by Nintendo because the polish level was so high. And like, I totally agree with it. And it seems like Reb was really impressed with us too.
Yeah, which is awesome because I trust Reb's judgment. And so I'm actually really looking forward to this game. The first one was such a surprise. Like I thought, no way. Even with the Mario tie-in, I thought there's no way that I'm going to like this. And then it came out and everyone's like, this game is great. So I finally bought it. Charles, do you have any history with the Mario Rabbids franchise or Rabbids at all? Or even Minions for that matter?
Rabbids, actually, I think my least favorite game I ever owned was Rabbids Travel in Time for the Nintendo 3DS. I got it because it was $20 at Target, and I think I only had like $21 left on my Target gift card or something like that. But this is much better than Rabbids Travel in Time. I can already tell just by looking at it. I played some of the first one. It never really hooked me, but I'm very into tactics games, and I've heard that this one with the bob-ombs and stuff gets even more complicated. There's more moving parts, which I always like when you feel like you're cornered and like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna die, and then you get like the perfect like galaxy brain moment of I can hit this person and that person and this person, then you win. As far as the rabbits inclusion in the game, it kind of feels like when there's like like a Hershey bar, but it's got nuts in it. And I'm like, ooh. I want nuts. I want a Hershey
like
bar. A
chunky. There's like a single raisin in there. So I think that was enough to
put me off of it. But I think the fact that they made a sequel and the gameplay in the sequel is reportedly better makes me just a little bit more interested than I was before.
Yeah. I highly recommend if you, you know, pick up the, if you have a Target gift card with at least $15 on it, because I think that's how much Kingdom Battle is. It's like always on sale. And it's a super good game and it's super fun. And I was really surprised. And like my kids took to it as well, which I didn't expect. I didn't think they would like to see Mario in like a strategy game. But yeah. Also, go check out Reb's preview again. And then, you know, say something nice to Reb online, because everybody loves Reb. Anyway, this is the major topic of today's show. It's we've got three olds, and then we have Charles. Am I to understand this? The Wii was your first video game console. Is that true? That's what Reb told me.
Christmas 2007, 7-year-old Charles got a Nintendo Wii. That was my first. Actually, I think I had technically gotten a DS Lite the year before, but it's a different options. It's a bigger deal when you're using up the TV and your dad wants to watch football and you're like, no, I gotta play Mario Galaxy.
Yeah.
Wow.
What games did you get when you got the Wii for Christmas? Or did you just have like the pack in Wii Sports?
The first year was probably Wii Sports and Wii Play. But as I grew older, I amassed many a Wii game. My favorite is probably Twilight Princess. I'm a big Twilight Princess fan.
There's nothing wrong with that.
But yes, I so too many to even list in a logical order. But yes, big Wii fan.
So would you say that you have nostalgia for the Nintendo Wii? If I were to turn my... I have right here. If I were to turn this on right now, would you just flash back to like that Christmas afternoon and you'd finally hooked it all up, calibrated your sensor bar?
That'd be really, really problematic for you guys, because I would be flashed back for the next 4 hours and we have a podcast to record. But yes, yeah, I still have my Wii.
Nice.
Wow.
Yeah, I have it in, I take it with me wherever I go. It's good.
Just in your back pocket of your Jenko jeans.
Yeah, you know, you gotta go to Starbucks, gotta bring your Wii in case you need to barter or something. Yeah.
It's the reason I picked this subject was actually because I was going through all my crap that I own that you can see like behind me at all times. And I found my Wii and I hooked it up and it started right up. And not only that, it had the correct time and date still. Yeah, and I haven't plugged it in. You know, I can't remember. You know, it's just someone was like, oh, it's just a CR302 battery, but I don't care. I was still impressed by it. And it made me realize, like, wait a second. Because my son, my 14-year-old son, came down and was like, oh, whoa, Wii, I remember this. And I was like, you do? You were, like, tiny when we had this thing. And he got nostalgic for it. And I thought, oh, my God, the Wii is retro now.
Wii's retro.
Yeah. Wii is retro.
Yeah,
that's upsetting. This is my first retro thing I lived through. What I'm learning right now.
Yep.
Yeah.
But the Wii is, I feel like the Wii isn't just retro because because technology has moved on, right? Like the Super NES with its Mode 7 graphics and the 16-bit style, definitely you look at it and you feel like it's retro. It's that Wii forked gaming for a little bit and it was this huge fad. And that ended, right? Like motion controls are now a component of games, whether you have a PlayStation 5 or a Switch, doesn't matter, right? Like they're part of games. They make things easier. Like in Splatoon, aiming is better because of the accelerometer. But games are not designed to be just motion experiences anymore like they were with Wii Sports. And so, yeah, that is in the rearview mirror of gaming now.
Yeah,
and I think there's something like special about being a kid and having that stuff. I feel like as an adult now, I play a game, and if I don't like it, if I think it's bad, I stop playing it. But when you're a kid, then you're like, I don't care because I get to swing the Wii remote and Spider-Man swings his web. Even though objectively, Spider-Man Web of Shadows is not a very good game, I played hundreds of hours because no other game did I own where I could swing the Wii remote and Spider-Man would swing his web, and I just love that.
The stuff I really loved with the Wii You know, there were definitely instances where the presence of the Wii remotes led to some wrong decisions. Like every developer wanted to use them, right? And 100%. some would use them to do genres like Zack and Wiki did, like a graphic adventure through the kind of like pointing at the screen that wouldn't have felt as good on another console. And I will say like Metroid Prime 3 did the kind of like the regular task of like opening a door. It made all that interesting and almost kind of like precedes all the simulator games that people are playing now, right? Where you're doing lawnmower or power washing or, you know, or like building construction stuff, like where you're doing regular daily tasks. Right. And they were just more fun on the Wii. But because everybody wanted to use the device that the Wii came with, right, it led to lots of decisions where things that were easier by pushing a button became motion controls. And like, I think nothing like Metroid Other M to me is like that's a failure of understanding the motion controls, because the turning sideways never felt good. Like taking analog controls away from me with a modern 3D Metroid game felt wrong.
Yeah.
And they only did that because it didn't want you to have the nunchuck tethered to it, because they wanted you to have this like turn it sideways and then point at the screen to change things. So it just didn't work for me. And I felt like when you go back now to the Wii library, you encounter a lot of games where you go, well, that would have been better without motion controls.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. John, what are your memories in and around the Nintendo Wii?
Well, kind of like coming from the opposite angle as Pear, like I feel like, you know, I picked up Okami on PS2 where it launched, and then like it really felt better on the Wii because you're drawing these painterly things. I still have a hard copy of that game with the IGN watermark on it. Thank you very much. Yeah, folks, that game shipped with an IGN watermark on the front of it, the Wii version of that game. Very funny. I have good memories of developers like Clover saying, okay, like bet, yeah, we'll make the Wii version of this game better than it originally was. I have good memories. This was the last time Nintendo seemed to actually care about the UX of its kind of you know, selection environment. You have music that was composed for menus of that game that are now going to be living on in eternity on TikTok forever. Like, that is just an unbelievable achievement.
We Shop Trap Remix.
This piece of music, this bossa nova kind of thing, permeate pop culture for 15 years at this point, and there's no sign of that stopping. It's amazing, you know. So like while the Wii kind of was this phenomenon outside of games as we cover them, it was also just a really good time that Nintendo was like in their bag doing like really cool stuff. And Switch is amazing. I love the Switch very, very much, but there's still something very, like, I don't know, really impressive with the way that they designed everything in the environment for Wii.
You brought up something really important. That's the menu system. Like it isn't as playful as the Wii U one with all the little people running around. But it felt so unique and intuitive once you like pointed at something and grabbed it. Like it had this kind of tactile grabby setup, and you moved it around. Like, and that really worked for me too. And actually the first time I tried out the Wii, my disappointment with the Wii was always, oh man, the graphics don't actually look better than the last generation, right? Like, so there was that hurdle, but then you try it and you feel it and you're like, okay, I get it. There's something really unique to it. And I actually thought the moment I used the Wii remote, I thought TV remotes would change forever. Sure. I'm like, there's just no way we're going to go back to like, you know, even like IR or RF controls where you're not pointing at the thing you want. Right. But turned out we did. And we're back to everything before Wii with controls like that.
Yep.
Yeah. And one of the things when I plugged my Wii in, and, you know, obviously, like we were talking about, the menu system is just, it is wonderful. So I was actually reading up on the Wii, and the design choice there was they wanted to make it feel like you were in a consumer electronics store and you had all these televisions that you were looking at and you were just browsing through them. It's a little bit less offensive than going to like Circuit City and having, you know, like Saturday or Sunday football in your face. But
Do you know what that is, Circuit City?
I can only imagine it's some long lost kingdom made of wires and microchips.
It's next to Blockbuster.
Actually, that's a level in Donkey Kong 64, right?
It is. Yeah. Okay. You pick up the crystal Pepsi and you go inside the Circuit City. Yeah.
Yes.
I forgot. I plugged in my Wii. Part of me was hoping to find all the games that I used to have. And what I ended up finding was the Wii U transfer tool, which made me remember, oh yeah, I moved all of those to my Wii U, which means I have to go and plug that back in. But
yeah,
what I also did, and it kind of made me sad, was I went to the Wii Vote channel and I had never gotten the results from the last vote. So I got, they all came in.
Oh, it is sad.
Would you rather have your, do you like getting your picture taken? Yes or no? And 75% of Wii users in, you know, whatever, 2012 did not like having their photo taken.
Were we drinking the Kool-Aid? Like, they did all this stuff with, they did, you know, basically kind of like social components.
Yeah.
They did news differently.
They did news.
News was stacking up on a world map by stories you hadn't seen. And then, like, yeah, the Wii Vote stuff. Like, they had all these weird weather. They had all these weird applications where I thought it was so freaking cool. And I actually used them more than I would have used on my phone or on my computer. It was so clever.
Yeah.
It's like that's the year Nintendo discovered the internet. They're like, wow, this is amazing. And after that, they're like, all right, we got it back in 2007.
You know what's interesting? They've been trying to do that for so long, right? Like, if you go back to the Super Famicom and the Satellaview, the 64DD had like all these kind of, they had aspirations to basically make it like this worldwide web for stuff that is fun, which in Japan included horse racing. I think they really succeeded. Like I remember my kids playing around with these applications and actually thinking they were really cool. Yeah. So they were onto something, but it just couldn't last, right? Because everyone has an iPhone.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is true. I also have the Netflix app, which I can't use because I don't have the Netflix disc to stream.
Right.
Oh, yeah. I have one. Next time you can borrow it. I have the Netflix disc, but that was, I remember when Netflix came out, for multiple years, more people used Netflix on Wii than any other device.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like that was the big success, how Netflix entered people's living rooms as a streaming platform.
I'll tell you a little story about Seth Macy, the guy who works at IGN now, and where I got my start was because, and this is Charles, this is for you. This is me, an old man, telling you about how things were in the before times.
Okay.
Netflix streaming came exclusively to Xbox 360 when it first came out. Like, only you could either watch it on your PC, which sucked because nobody wanted to do that, or you could watch it on your Xbox 360, which is hooked to your TV. There was only about 10,000 movies on there. Most of them were like not even B movies. They were like Q or like Z movies. They were just way down on the alphabet because they were horrible. 1UP.com, rest in peace, put out a call for bloggers to cover Netflix on the Xbox 360 because it was such a new and novel thing. And I put in my application and I was the guy who wrote three articles a month about what was new on Netflix on year 360.
Wow.
That's how interesting and exciting it was way back then. Yeah, like we're seeing footage right now of Netflix running on the Xbox 360. Selection was bad. I didn't realize they had Mystery Science Theater.
They had Mystery Science on there at one point.
Yeah.
Okay. That's actually
and Jaws. That's and, not bad. And Labyrinth.
Caddyshack. Classic.
Dance Magic Dance.
Family Guy, which most people now only know from memes and don't realize that that was
That's a TV show. Yeah, that's program. Right. Yeah.
It's not particularly good. But I kind of forgot where I was going with this. But Netflix streaming is what got me started. That was my first paid gig. I got $15 a post. So I made $45 a month.
Yeah.
At most. It was
thrilling. Back then, that paid rent.
Yep, back then you could pay rent and you could take your best lady out for a malted.
Golly.
It was a very good time.
Yeah, it's I mean, I find the Wii era just fascinating. And I honestly have nothing but love for the console at its point in time now, looking back. But I can also remember when the games were revealed at E3 and like our collective editorial team was like, oh my God, how do the graphics look worse than GameCube? Right. You know, there was this sort of shock where we didn't understand what Nintendo was doing. And from kind of like a core gamer's perspective, we always crave like shinier, better, more effects, more beautiful, higher resolution. It was a little bit of a you know, bucket of cold water at that point. But then we all were instant believers when we played Wii Sports, and it was bowling that sold us
out.
So good. Well, we've reminisced about Wii, but I need you all to sharpen your number two pencils because I've prepared a Nintendo Wii quiz, which weirdly was another thing that people were like, hey, you should have we should win things by listening to the show. You should have a quiz. And I was like, I'm actually making one. Get out of my head, people. But I have a quiz about the Nintendo Wii's library of games. There were over 1600 games for the Nintendo Wii. 1637, not all of them released, and that includes like there was like a what was that singing show that used to be very popular? Anyway,
American Idol?
No, it was a different
Sing
one
Star?
But no, maybe right. There was one anyway. there are a surprising amount of games specifically for Germany, which I didn't expect. I didn't add any of those because I didn't think it would be fair to the other panelists.
Thanks.
So sorry, Pear.
Yeah.
Plus, I would butcher the pronunciation. Anyway, so which of the following three games is not a Wii game? A, The Smurfs. B, The Smurfs 2. Or C, The Smurfs Dance Party. And you're welcome to discuss it among each other.
The Smurfs 2.
I'm going to say Smurfs 2 because I think that game came out for the Wii U.
Okay. I think Smurfs 2 is not a Wii game.
Okay.
Because everything Dance Party is a Wii
game. Is a Wii game.
The Smurfs 2 was developed by WayForward and published by Ubisoft for the Nintendo Wii. The Smurfs was never on Nintendo Wii. It was just the Smurfs 2.
Wow.
So this is like Goat Simulator 3, where they just...
I'm kind of interested just finding out that WayForward developed it, because I like pretty much everything that WayForward has ever done. So I'm sure you could find this at your local Goodwill for $3.
Sorry, the footage we're seeing has to be the DS game or something.
Yeah,
right?
This looks very DS.
I was like, wow, they really did not get the tech right. Okay, never mind.
Hey, what is the German Smurfs in German? Is Schlumpfe?
Die Schlumpfe.
Schlumpfe.
I love that
too.
Die Schlumpfe.
Die Schlumpfe. Smurfs Dance Party was a Ubisoft game, which no surprise there. A lot of dance games. All right. Which 2000s era television drama did not appear on the Nintendo Wii as a video game? A, Grey's Anatomy. B, CSI. C, NCIS. Or D, 24.
I'm going to say 24.
Grey's Anatomy.
I'm also going to say Grey's Anatomy because, I don't think it was Grey's Anatomy.
It could have been a, you know, like a operating table game.
Sure.
Still,
I see it.
It seems too old for that audience.
Yeah.
Well, all right. So, Charles, you're saying 24 was not on, and John and Pear, you're saying Grey's Anatomy was not a Wii game. According to Wikipedia, Grey's Anatomy, the video game, is set during the fourth season of the medical drama Grey's Anatomy in an original storyline in which the doctors have to deal with a diphtheria outbreak. The game takes the form of a visual novel interspersed with minigames.
Are you serious?
I'm procuring this game right now.
Wow. I need it.
There's also three CSI games. CSI Deadly Intent, CSI Fatal Conspiracy, and CSI Hard Evidence. Those were all developed by Telltale, which I was surprised to find out. And the NCIS game was developed by Ubisoft Shanghai. Ubisoft appeared a lot, and I wasn't seeking or searching out games by Ubisoft, but they made a lot of Wii games.
They made a lot of crap.
Yeah, they sure did. So Charles, you were correct. 24 did not appear on Wii. However, there is a PlayStation 2 24 game.
That's the one I remember. I think, the guy who made the bargain bin at Target and Circuit City must have had stock in Ubisoft or something. Or vice versa. Seriously, I remember we used to capture every game released in our games database. And like we got to the Wii era where our games database guy said, like, I cannot do it, Captain.
Yeah,
like
right.
There was just so much stuff. And there would be no press releases or announcements. You would literally go to like a Walmart and like, what the hell is this?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Well, when I was researching this, you know, there is a list of every game on Wikipedia, of course, that came out for the. This doesn't include WiiWare games, actually. Mm-hmm. Mm. But like a surprising majority of them just don't have a Wikipedia article at all. Because, like you said, they're just so random, and there's just no information about them anymore.
Yeah, and it's a lot of smaller, like Microids and stuff, like smaller studios, like cranked out stuff. And sometimes there were flash game conversions.
Yes, that was a big thing back then.
A lot
online
of party
flash
games. Where somebody just added Waggle, and that was it.
That's all you needed. There's a lot of waggling going on back.
Well, we're really bad at this game, Seth. Do you have any other games?
No, I have. I have a Ubisoft, another Ubisoft question.
Oh, God.
What was the last Just Dance game released for Nintendo Wii?
Oh, totally guessing now.
Yeah.
I know this one, I think.
Okay.
Just Dance 2019.
Okay.
I think it's like 2020. I think it's like more recent.
Yeah, maybe.
Okay. Well,
is this multiple choice or are we just guessing?
No. This is, I mean...
Okay, well, my guess is
multiple choice from all the. Your guess is what?
I think the last year at Just Dance came out for the Wii was 2020. I don't know if that means it's Just Dance 2021. Like I don't know exactly how the years of it were.
Came out in 2020.
John and Charles, you are correct.
Wow,
it was Just Dance 2020 for the Nintendo Wii. There were 23 Just Dance titles.
Wow.
Because it's a 23-year-old console, yeah.
There was a lot of just slight variant, you know, like Just Dance Kids and Just Dance Kids 2 and, you know, weird things like that. But yeah, 2020 was the last Wii release of Just Dance, and I believe the last Wii game to come out was Just Dance 2020. I still remember seeing it at Walmart, like, in 2019 and being like, what is happening in this pre-pandemic world. And, you know, we didn't know what was coming back then.
Look, the more casual the audience, right? Like the longer they keep devices and don't upgrade. And I remember Ubisoft telling us, like whenever we made jokes about there being another Just Dance for Wii, after nobody owned the console anymore, they're like, laugh it up. It sells so well, like every time, you know?
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that's what we kind of forget now with the way that game. I mean, the Switch is obviously a huge success and is broken, you know, crossover appeal, but the Wii, just everybody had a Wii. Everybody's grandma had a Wii. You would go over to Grand-Grand's house.
Over.
She'd be like, could you help me set the clock again?
Yeah. She just over 100 million units sold, right?
Yeah.
And the Wii, even though there was an iteration, different hardware iteration. It's not like the DS where there are multiple lines of devices where you would want to replace the one you already own. That's 100 million. That's a really, really big install base.
It is wild. All right. This is the lightning round. Which of the following games are real and which are ones I just made up when I was making this list? So first, Guinness World Records, the video game.
Real.
Real.
It's a real game. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think it's a collection of mini games. What a surprise there. The Hardy Boys, The Hidden Theft.
Real.
Real.
Fake.
That's also a real game.
Oh, my God.
Because you know how kids love The Hardy Boys.
Love them. Yeah.
Man, I remember going to Toys R Us that day, and it was just a bedlam. Everyone just had Hardy Boys fever that day. All right. Yo Gabba Gabba, Get the Sillies Out.
Real.
I'm gonna say real because if you made the subtitle "Get the Sillies Out," I'm okay with being wrong.
Exactly.
I think I agree. Yeah. It's real. Yeah.
That is not a real game.
What?
Good job,
amazing.
Seth. I have so much
children's program.
For you.
Well, I have an 18-year-old and a 14-year-old. So Yo Gabba Gabba. I actually like Yo Gabba Gabba more than they did. I'd be like, Biz Markie is on TV right now, kids. And so, yes, that is not a real game. Jerry Rice and Nitus's Dog Football.
I own this game, Seth Macy. So, real.
That is a real game.
It is
Jerry Rice,
wild.
Is it really? I don't know anything about it other than, like, I remember Jerry Rice was on, like, a huge public relations kick for this game. Like,
yep.
1UP used to get all sorts of, you know, press releases about it. And it's, could you just explain what's going on?
Please.
It's like a little bit like a blitz. You have different breeds of dogs on your team that excel at different things. And it's, I think it's like 5-on-5 football. You play in these like weird terrains with like obstacles, like a mansion in Beverly Hills. Each of the characters you play as are quarterbacks and they have all their different personalities and it plays.
Look at that.
It plays terribly. Oh. Yeah, I played about 2 hours of this game.
Look at the camera.
Mm-hmm. I was kind of hoping that this was a hidden gem because I remember just Jerry Rice. I was touched by how much he loved his dog.
Oh yeah,
he made a game about his dog and went like, on a media tour.
The goodwill kind of injected into this game makes it worth trying. But you can get it on Steam right now. By the way. Right. So yeah, like that's how
100% positive reviews from users.
So yeah, it is a hidden gem in a sense.
Not expecting someone to own one of the games on this list. So
that's what I'm
shout out. It's an
extremely John Warren type of like nonsense game. I feel like
yeah.
Hats right. off to you.
A few more. Chrysler Motorsports minivan racing, real or made up?
Made up.
Real.
That was one I just made up.
I love the idea though.
Dang,
My first car was a champagne colored Chrysler Town and Country. So
nice. You know what? In hindsight, I should have known it was fake because it didn't have like extreme or something in the title. It sounded too descriptive. Like Wii games always have like this amazing. Feel to them.
Y'all remember how good the Volkswagen Bug Racing though was on.
That's kind of where I was trying to go.
Adventure racing.
Yeah, that game was great. Anyway.
Yeah.
From the cream of the crop of the Need for Speed team.
Mm-hmm. Oh wow, I did not know that. All right, Pimp My Ride.
Yeah, that's real.
I think that's real.
That's a real game. Yeah. I don't know. It's probably a collection of mini games. Also, there's a great article I just read about how Pimp My Ride was completely fake and everyone involved was borderline criminal. So, all right. Kimbo Slice Ultimate Cage Fighter.
Ooh. Wow.
Say that again.
Kimbo Slice Ultimate Cage Fighter.
I'm going to say real.
I'm going to say real too, but it seems like something Seth would like to be real.
I know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what the score is right now. I don't think anyone's keeping score.
Nobody's keeping score. I'm just like, whose line is it anyway?
Oh, yeah. I see.
So I'm going to say that it's real and be on the same side as everyone else because I think I might be a little bit ahead right now. And if you guys both get a point, then it's outward. So I'm going to say I'm fully shooting in the dark.
All right. Kimbo Slice is a departed street fighter who was went viral as he was coming up. He never really did that well in professional MMA, but that is not a real game. However, there is a fitness game called UFC Personal Trainer.
I remember that.
Nice.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, no Kimbo Slice. This is the final one. Daisy Fuentes Pilates.
I know that's real.
I think that's real.
I'm saying real.
I'm curious, Per, how do you know that that's real?
Because that is a bargain bin title that I've actually seen, and I said out loud, why?
You gotta get that rebalance board, you know?
It is a real game, and there is a video series that IGN did years and years ago called, I can't say the word, it's free SH exclamation point T, where Chris Carl, it's a very cable access style show, and Chris Carl in a unicorn shirt is talking about Daisy Fuentes Pilates. And how great of a game it is, and how beautiful he thinks.
That's free, incredible. Free bleep in hindsight, because we titled it that, and because we made it so cable access-y, people didn't believe it was real. It was actually, we gave away so much stuff on that show. Like, but people won stuff, and they didn't believe us. And on YouTube, they thought we were being serious. Like, the show had Cheech and Chong on it. It was completely bonkers, and like it was wonderful, and nobody understood it. Every episode did like 10,000 views or something, and we eventually canceled it.
But there it is. There's Chris. Yeah. And here's the funny thing about that T-shirt. I own that T-shirt. My wife wears it more often than I do, but I think I might be able to fit into it now. I've been doing some pilates. So I'm much, much more spelt. But yeah, that's a real game. That's a real old IGN video. And that's a VP at Paramount Plus right
now, Chris Carr. That's right. He's producing the behind the scenes Star Trek series for you right now. There.
Yep. Yeah, man, that's good stuff. We should go back, but we'll maybe give it a better title.
No, we can't, because people just don't trust it.
Oh, they'll trust me if I host it.
The internet has turned so mistrusting. Like, they think everything's fake or paid for, and it's look, the people who trusted it, they got that Xbox 360. So
yeah, jokes on that. You. Jokes on you, untrusting people. So thank you for playing our Wii quiz. You all passed with flying colors. And it was a lot of fun. And I think we all learned something today. And that is, we had 1,637 games, and about 100 of them were good. And the rest were not good. And you can't play most of them anymore, which is too bad. So now it is time for question block. And I have a lot of question block questions, because people have been questioning me to question block. So I got a little ahead of myself there. Shannon Gillette asks, what is the best Mario power up? And I have an answer for this already. So I'm just going to sit back and see if anybody else says it first. Everyone's looking. Pear's looking very stern.
Well, because my mind was blown when I got the manto, what is it called in English? The cape in Super Mario World.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. When I got that power up, that blew my mind, because you could access places and you could do things in Mario that felt like too powerful. Like, it felt like they gave me the power to break the game. And like, in some cases,
yeah.
It was so cool. I love that one, but it's hard to argue against some of the later power ups too. I don't know. I'll let you the other guys answer too, but like, I would still probably pick the cape.
I'm a big Tanuki person, you know, old school Mario 3 Tanuki, more than like 3D Land. But like, yeah, you could turn into a statue. Those statues showed up in Super Mario Odyssey. And, you know, it's like, it's a nice through line for the entire series, a real departure from kind of what you could do with Mario up to that point. You know, the leaf was great, but you could turn into a cool Tanuki. I love that guy.
So I never got the turning into a statue thing. Like, I agree with you. It was a cool power up, that's like from Tom Hanks, like the movie Big, where he has this whole speech about, is it fun to transform this toy into a house, right? Like, why are you excited about turning into something that can't move?
Because you're invulnerable. You can just let the
Yeah, but you can't move.
It's like, they introduced stealth. It became the first immersive sim, is what I'm talking about. You know, it's like stealth elements in Mario 3. You got to turn invulnerable, let people get around you. I don't know. It was so strange to me when I was a kid. I didn't get it. I still don't, but I still have a lot of nostalgia for it.
I always thought it was like a monkey's paw genie wish, where Mario is like, I would like to be invulnerable. Right. He's statue, boom.
Yeah.
All right. What about you, Charles?
Mine, I'm going back and forth between the propeller hat, which I feel like is just extremely versatile. Like, if I needed to survive in a level, they're like, if you don't die once in this level in Mario, you're going to win $1,000. I'd be like, give me the propeller hat because I'll survive. My favorite I have, I don't know if it's the best power up, and I don't actually remember how often it occurred, but there's like a red flying cap in Super Mario Galaxy where you can get these stars and fly around. I thought that one was very fun. That stood out to me too.
Mario 64 Charles, which is this older game, also has the flying power up.
It's different though, because he doesn't have wings on his head.
No, totally.
Pear. I played Super Mario 64 DS.
All right.
So I know all about that.
You, did you have the little strap that you could use to fix the controls?
I forgot about that.
Yeah. Hey, so the propeller hat, that was the other one I was thinking about, where I was like,
Good.
That is an example of the tactile stuff being done brilliantly on the Wii, where when you shake the remote, you get this real sense of like, you're like winding it up, right? And it has this like feedback. I always loved that, like the way it felt.
Yeah. Yeah, those are great answers, but they're all wrong.
What about you, Seth?
Well, the best power up in all of Mario history is the frog suit from Mario 3. And I don't know why, but it was my favorite thing. And you have to understand that back then, when Mario 3 was being promoted heavily, before that, the only thing when Mario would get big or Mario would shoot fire, and that was it. And then all of a sudden, they're like, Mario can turn into a tanuki, which you don't. Oh, by the way, American kids, you don't know what that is. You think it's a raccoon, but it's not.
It's not.
It's more closely related to the bear. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's true. But oh, God, there's so many of them, because now I'm backtracking, because I'm like, well, Kuribo's shoe. I love that you would into a Goomba's shoe and like,
that's be able not to a also, power up, though. That's it just is, a shoe.
It's a, you know? It's a shoe that makes you invulnerable, and you can cross over the little Pac-Man piranha plants.
Again. Oh, yeah. That's like the genie just being a total jerk back to Mario again. It's like, you want a cool ride? How about a shoe?
Giant boots.
Yeah.
One big boot.
We never knew until many years later who Kuribo was. We just thought it was a guy from Japan. But that's what the Goombas are called in Japan, actually. So they just didn't bother to translate it. The frog suit is like actually one of my favorites, and I don't know why. I just love the idea that Mario could swim better. But the real answer is the red hat with the wings from Mario 64, because the first time you did that was like one of the most amazing experiences I think I can ever, like I ever had in video games. I put that up there with the first time I played VR and the first time I just played like Super Mario, the original one, because it was just so mind blowing. And it's not limitless. You can't break the game. I mean, actually, wait a minute. I bet Mark Medina knows how to break the game with it.
Yeah, I'm sure you can break the game.
Yeah, it's a pretty broken game. But my answer is the hat as well. Anything that makes Mario fly is good. Flying and swimming.
Yeah. I do want to say also real quick that I actually have played Mario 64 on the Wii Virtual Console. Mm. That was just a thing I didn't really get to talk about, but like as a kid, I really appreciated that the Wii had all these like older games I could just access through the store, and it had GameCube backwards compatibility. And just as we're reminiscing on this Mario stuff, it's like I've never played with the frog suit before, and I could on the Nintendo Switch Online, I'm pretty sure.
Yep.
But just that's another thing I miss about the Wii, is that I felt like people would mention things online. People talk about Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time on forums or whatever, and I could be like, oh, I can just play that on my Wii, and I did. And there's so many things I experienced that I can't do anymore.
Yeah. Yep. The frog suit's only in level 4, and I think only in 2 levels in level 4. So I would actually play level 4 just to get the frog suit. I don't know why. Weird little kid, I guess. It's funny that you mentioned that. I didn't. One of the questions that I meant to put in here was somebody was asking, do we prefer? Oh, actually, I did put it. Good from thanks past me. Travis Crawford says, do you like collections of games on cartridge digital, like the Genesis or Cowabunga collections, or would you rather have them available via an online service like NSO or Virtual Console? And I don't know. Personally, I loved Virtual Console because, like Charles, like you're saying, you could just access these games. But I also love buying physical games and having them forever. Like, that's the reason I hooked up my Wii, was to play my Virtual Console games, which, by the way, are on my Wii U, which I don't know, they might be corrupted now. Mm. So I'm curious as to what everyone else thinks. You know, do you prefer a collection on a disc, or excuse me, on a cartridge, or would you rather have a service where you could just access them?
I'll give a hybrid answer. I mean, I don't think I really care so much about the physical aspect of it. Honestly, I've gone pretty digital over the past few years and mostly don't regret it, although the way that these big companies are treating that stuff has been a little disheartening. But like, the Cowabunga collection is a really good example of a collection that like knows why it should be a collection. It gets together a lot of behind the scenes, cutting room floor, whatever stuff that comes with the collection. And it's like, wow, that's great. Nintendo first party, sorry, is actually pretty bad at this. Like,
really,
the All-Stars Mario could have gone all out with stuff, with like development stuff that I know we never see out of Japan. I get that, but like, it seemed like such an obvious opportunity to package the game with something cool. It came with soundtracks things like that. It made it kind of special, but like they didn't do enough, I think, with a cool collection. If you do cool stuff with a collection, I like collection. If you're not going to do cool stuff, I just like a la carte on a service.
That's why where I am too. I would love a Metroid collection, but I don't just want every Metroid game on a cartridge. No. The other factor is sometimes you get games that are very, very similar. Like let's do a Castlevania collection, right? Like just even the DS games. And when you get them all at once, for me personally, it's daunting. I'm like, I'm going to pick my favorite to play and I'm not going to be able to enjoy the entire collection. However, when it's part of Nintendo Online, where you get one game now and then you get the next one, you get Symphony of the Night, like in a couple of weeks later, I actually have more time to experience them and kind of like look forward to the next one. But it would be nice if there was that sort of cadence and that sort of announcement. Like if Nintendo had a season where it's like the season of Castlevania and they told you, 2 weeks from now, you get this one. 4 weeks from now, you get that one. That would be really exciting.
I have the perfect season. The Halloween season. On account of how spooky it is.
Oh, there you go.
Give me a call, Nintendo. We can talk.
I think I prefer a virtual store. Honestly, I'm not really one for a physical collection, but it's also, I think we're getting different things out of this, because for you guys, it's like, let me revisit a memory or, you know, an old thing that I really liked back then that I don't have access to anymore. And for me, I was thinking of it like, this is my, like Shakespeare is playing the original Super Mario Bros. Or whatever. Like, I feel like I got to read up to have the literacy to participate in like game design circles and whatnot. Yeah. And for me, I just like having a library of stuff where it's like, if I want to play this game, I have the option to. And I think probably what I care about more than the form it is the accessibility of it. But I guess if I could only pick one, I'd pick physical, because like this, well, I don't know. Because the store closing, the Wii U and 3DS store closing in like March, is something I dread. I just keep thinking about that, because I'm gonna buy a bunch of games and I've been putting it off, but it's like I don't know. I'm gonna mourn the loss of having access to some of this stuff. Of like, I played Super Paper Mario, the original, on my Wii U, because that's where I could access it. And those games hold up and they're good and they deserve to be played. And it's a shame that it's not how it always is.
Yeah. I am a sucker and I just love to buy things. So put out physical editions and let me just, like, I have, where is it? I think I've shown it before, but I bought that. Oh, here it is. I bought the very expensive Cowabunga collection, special edition. This was not cheap. It was $150. I had to have it.
Beautiful.
I have not even opened it yet. What is my problem?
Well, because in 10 years, that's so much money.
That is true. Yeah. That is actually, there was a sealed copy of Mike Tyson's Punch Out on Shop Goodwill that ended up going for like, I think $35,000, because it was in absolutely pristine new old stock condition. We're not going to go into me talking about auction sites. I got a serious problem. I bought Donkey Kong 64, for Christ's sakes. For heaven's sakes, excuse
me. This is actually an intervention, Seth.
Yeah, we need to talk.
I appreciate it. I appreciate the all care for me, but I have to get to the next question. Kelly Hoffert says, I put 50 hours into Splatoon 3 in the first 10 days, which is probably the most I've ever played a game that quickly. So I'm curious, what is the most you've played a new game that you didn't have to play for work? And I'm curious, what is the most quickly, because we are sadly running out.
Forza Horizon 5 for me. You know, I love racing games, obviously. So, you know, I buy many of them. I played lots of Gran Turismo as well. But like Forza Horizon, because of the sort of like reward structure and the kind of like weekly check-ins, I have way over 200 hours in that one and probably 300 now. And it's just, I still play it.
Wow. All right. John, what about you? What's the game that you've put the most time in the quickliest?
I got 500 moons on Odyssey in about a weekend.
Wow.
Yeah, like
that's concerning.
I devoured that game.
Yeah. It's a great game.
Yeah.
Charles, what about you?
For me, I'm thinking it's either got to be like a Pokemon game. Like I remember Pokemon White. I got that the day it came out. That was my first pre-order, 11-year-old Charles. But it also might just be Persona 5. I just play that game in, in such long binge sessions that, like, not when it came out. I guess that was my caveat. That wasn't the second it came out. But once I got my hands on it, it was like, you know, 3 weeks later, I had 150 hours in it or whatever.
Mine are all share common theme. Probably the first game that I just set down from the minute I popped it in and was just glued to it was absolutely Elder Scrolls Oblivion. Like that, I'd never seen anything like, well, that's not true. I'd played Daggerfall, but Daggerfall is a long ways away from Elder Scrolls Oblivion.
It is.
And I just played that for, I think, the entirety of a weekend, to the point where I would go out into my yard and I would be trying to pick herbs to make potions with later. Later on, the same thing happened with Skyrim. And I've told that story 100 times. Like, I quit smoking because I played Skyrim every time I had a craving. So for three straight days, I just played Skyrim, and you know, I've been
clean. That's amazing.
I've been clean ever since. So I was completely, I just transferred the addiction. I mean, it's probably not healthy, but
video games save lives.
Paxel off the market. Now it's just Elder Scrolls Skyrim.
I actually have a copy of the Stop Smoking game for Nintendo DS that was has the box quote from, I think, Sir Anthony Hopkins. I think it's the only DS game about how it helped him quit smoking. But
wow.
The other two games were Metal Gear Solid 5 and Red Dead Redemption 2. If it's an open world game, that if it grabs me, that's it. That's all I want to do. I am completely obsessed about living in that world. I think Red Dead Redemption 2 is probably the most I've ever felt that I was in a different era and world and time. And I know that people have a lot of complaints about that game. That's not even a Nintendo game, so we can't talk about it anyway. Because people get frustrated with me. So I'm sorry to you. But sadly, everyone's least favorite part of the show. It's all the time we have for this week's Nintendo Voice Chat. Make sure to follow us on Twitter at NVC Podcast. Submit your question block questions on the NVC Facebook group. And one of these days, I'm going to get myself added to that email alias so I can get the actual emails and you can start emailing them to us. But, John, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at @floppyadult. You can also find a hashtag called hashtag fanbite layoffs over there if you want to help one of the many amazing people, Charles and I are two of them, who were laid off last week and looking for full-time work next. Please go check that out. Charles is amazing. Charles was the best intern. Ready for whatever. Gosh. We loved having him this summer, so
awesome. Charles, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter at chuckduck365. And I want to say, just as far as question bot questions go, always believe, because I submitted questions, I think, for years, and then I finally got mine on 2 or 3 years ago, and I think it was about eating the Pokemon Farfetch'd.
I remember that one.
Because it comes with a leek. So I was like, it's great.
That's
it's
a built-in Yakitori ingredient. That's what it is. It's a Yakitori,
ChuckDuck365 on Twitter.
That is awesome. Well, John and Charles, thank you so much. This was an awesome show pair. Thank you, as always. Red, I want to thank you on the ones and twos, but most of all, I want to thank you, the audience, for hanging out with us. Remember, NBC is the only place where you can
get the thing.
The bizarro combination of Mario, Rabbids, and a tactics game in Mario plus Rabbids Kingdom Battle somehow came together into something astonishingly delightful, which left Ubisoft with a daunting task and sparks of hope, sparking a big enough bombshell to properly catch us all off guard again. But after about 4 hours, with Mario plus Rabbids Sparks of Hope, I'm feeling confident Ubisoft has given Mario plus Rabbids the dynamite needed to surprise its audience once more. On the exploration side, transforming Mario plus Rabbids from its linear world structure to more free-roaming open levels was possibly the best upgrade the team could have made. Ubisoft has put in a lot of work to make each zone feel wonderfully open-ended, with a lot of extra space devoted to telling stories with NPCs and environments that the first game never could have. and it's all stuffed with side quests, coins, treasures, and dopey little rabid vignettes that make each area highly distracting. But even more important than the exploration, I was surprised by how utterly blown open Mario plus Rabbids has become, thanks to the shifts and how movement and combat work. Free movement alone opens up a feast of tactical possibilities, and offers time and space to understand the battlefield possibilities on a given turn. But that's combined with other significant changes. Each character now has 2 action points to spend per turn on attacking, special moves, and item use, giving every combat situation a ridiculous array of viable approaches. The most exciting new addition, by far, are the sparks. Status effects are gone, but replaced with elements such as fire, water, ice, and others that are applied to opponents by equipping sparks to characters and using them to spice up attacks with elemental energy. This also means enemies, and your team, have weaknesses and resistances to keep in mind, a change which pushed me to spend a meaningful period of time analyzing the battlefield and enemy types. I had to really, really think about my roster and equipment. It's much harder to bulldoze your way through story fights. Except it's also easier, but only if you want it to be, thanks to a couple wonderful key changes. For one, there's a difficulty selection you can adjust at any time to toggle between easy, normal, and hard battles. Additionally, it's now more possible to grind meaningfully. It wasn't necessary in the sections I played, but had I struggled, I know I could have looped back, redone some story fights, battled some of the roaming enemies on the map again, or done some side quests to level up my party. This should all be extremely welcome news, as both features broaden the range of people who can enjoy Sparks of Hope. It continues to welcome in the tactics newbies, even as it grows more complex, and the true tactical connoisseurs can challenge themselves even more. The one change I'm still genuinely uncertain about, though, involves the rabbits themselves. They talk now. Funky footwork, making you faint. Not just incoherent screaming, but they have fully written out, grammatically correct dialogue now, alongside occasional voice acting, interspersed with their more conventional bois-like utterances. Ran the table. On one hand, we get some great characterization this way. I'm not sure we'd quite feel the same depth of utter ennui from Rabid Rosalina, or clear edgelordery from, well, Edge, without them actually talking. I was gonna read. But on the other hand, it's kinda weird, you know? It feels inherently un-Rabid of them to speak. I genuinely have no idea how this will land by the time Sparks of Hope is done. But I still love the Rabbids, talking or not. Ubisoft accomplished one heck of a feat in making these dorky pests so charming, with both its goofy lineup of rabid NPCs and its roster of humorous Mario wannabes. The greater cast of the first game is almost entirely available right out of the gate in Sparks of Hope, and the initial rabid deluge both adds to the tactical possibilities and gives the new members like Edge and Rabid Rosalina much more space to shine. And no one can take the spotlight away from Kingdom Battle favorites, like the phone-obsessed Rabid Peach, who's become a proper deuterogonist next to Mario himself. A typical side effect of getting to preview more than a few hours of something is that when that thing finally comes out, I find myself sprinting through the content I've already seen to get to the juicy new nuggets beyond. But I don't feel that way about Sparks of Hope. What I played was wildly fun and so full of possibility, I'm eager to try it again, but using different characters and strategies. I can't wait to see what chaos the Rabbids and I can cause next time. For more on Mario plus Rabbids Sparks of Hope, check out the official gameplay trailer, as well as the original reveal trailer.